Yeah. I can diagnose it. It's a failed analysis.
For those of you watching online, we also welcome you to this time of worship and hope that it is inspirational to you. And as always, if you have needs, please contact the church office. We will do our best to meet your needs. The coffee and conversation this morning will be extra special because this morning we are honoring our graduates and we are also receiving new members of the church, and we have a nice cake and some gluten-free cupcakes to help celebrate with that. So please stay and have some cake and some coffee and punch, water, whatever.
No punch,
just water. All right. Water and coffee or tea. And Julia, how very nice to see you, but what are you doing here? Maybe this will be just the trick. All right.
Next well, slide. You know, I could, oh gosh, is that loud?
That's hot.
It's very hot. I was sharing with your mother that when I was at the Little's Corners charge, I had someone that was like, I think they were a week overdue. And I had prayed for them during the morning prayer. And then in the sermon, it was Advent, you know, so I worked them into that, like we're all eagerly waiting. I get a call when I get home from the third service, that was the second service, from her mother. Steph told me to call you and say, she's in the hospital, and I hear Steph saying something in the background, and then she goes, oh yeah, and it's your fault. I said, I'm really thankful I'm a female pastor then.
It's good to see you, Julia.
The baby was born by 1 o'clock that day.
So we can take care of this anytime.
So, yes, please stay afterward. Personal items for the Operation Christmas Child. And come on up.
Yeah, it's June 9th and June.
Yeah, we're not being one.
Yeah, I forgot to change that part.
You want to
do something, you
got to
do it yourself.
You want it done right. Okay. I wanted to update you because things have been a little more confusing as we go to the end of our collection. And it's a good thing because we over-collected a lot of stuff. It's wonderful. But I'm going to tell you what we would like to have happen in the next 4 months. June, what we're now starting, is the month of toys. We have overcollected, so we only need 8. So don't run out buying toys, because we really don't need them. But July, we are needing clothing, and actually we need 83 items out of 100, so we really do need clothing. And I'm going to give you a couple of ideas, because you don't have to go out and buy wardrobes or anything. It's just little, because they have to fit in these boxes. Shirts, pants, shorts, sundresses, underwear, socks, shoes, flip-flops, things like that, but little. August, we need school supplies, only 35 items needed because we've been pretty well with that. Those are typical things that you would expect, like pencils, sharpeners, erasers, colored pencils, crayons, index cards, solar calculators, they make skinny little ones, safety scissors, rulers, glue sticks, things like that. And September, again, we are short. We need games, and we need 92 of them out of 100. But my advice on the games is this. You know, travel size games, you get little scrabbles and little things. Also, don't get hung up on whether it's a game, is it a craft, is it a toy, it doesn't matter. Is it something that's going to give this child happiness to play with? If it does, that's what we want. Again, thank you, you guys are so generous, and you're blessed, and you are providing blessings. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pat, and if you need some further clarification, stop and see Pat after church. After worship, excuse me. The Cradle Ministry, Hannah, it's still out. Very nice to see you this morning. Vacation Bible School, it's coming, and Julia needs help, and there's still room to sign up in the gathering space on that sign-up sheet. So you don't want her father or her husband coming after you. So please sign up. Anyway, Colson Fellows, again, the information is out there. We urge you to take a look at that information. Are there other announcements that need to be made? Then let us pause for a word of prayer. Holy Father and gracious God, we do give you our thanks and our praise that we can be here this morning as the body of Christ to give you our praise, our thanks, and our worship. As we worship together, may our worship be found acceptable in your sight, and we pray your presence with us. In Jesus' name, amen. And now, as you are able, and so led, if you would care to stand and join with the praise team as we sing our two opening songs, Trading My Sorrows and Voice of Truth. Thank you for filling in on the keyboard, and our singers, thank you. Thank you. Jim and I need all the help we can get. Or at least I do. When we quiet ourselves, do we hear that voice? Do we hear that voice? And is our answer yes? Yes, Lord. I've gotten a little bit ahead of myself, but I think we'll proceed with the morning prayer and then come back to a recognition of graduates. So let us pray together. Oh Lord God, we do give you our thanks and our praise this morning for the ability to be here openly and freely to give you our praise and our worship. And in those quiet moments of our lives, when we truly stop and listen, may we hear your voice, and may our answer be yes. We do praise you for that we are fortunate to have had beautiful weather for this last several weeks, especially yesterday. While other areas of the country and other areas of the world are just being bombarded with fall weather. So we thank you for that gift to us. We thank you most of all for the gift of your Son Jesus and the sacrifice that he was willing to make that we might enjoy eternal life. We do have several prayer concerns this morning. Again, we pray for our good friend, Sandy Foltz. And we pray for Rick Smith as he is awaiting his heart surgery this week. For the family of Gary Hughes, a good friend of Pastor Lee and mayor of Harrisville, died very suddenly from a heart attack. We pray also for one of Pastor Lee's friends, for the family of Stan Sowery. Things that remain on our heart, we lay them before you, knowing that you hear them. We do praise you for the gift of healing and pray for all those that are going through illness, sickness, disease, post-surgery, that you would give them the gift of healing. We do pray for our graduates as they continue on with their education or their career. We ask that you might still be central to their lives. And for those joining the church this morning, may that same be true. Lord, as we listen to the evening news, it seems the political divide just keeps getting deeper and deeper, and much of the rhetoric becomes less and less becoming of those who call themselves statesmen. So we ask for your presence with them and a change of heart. And we pray for peace around the world. We pray for our government leaders, and we pray for all cities overcome with drugs and homelessness. May we find a way to be your hands and feet. Lord, we pray for intervention. We pray for revival. That this country would turn its face back to you. As always, we pray for Pastor Lee as our spiritual leader and our shepherd, and for this congregation. You have blessed us with the ability to engage in many witnessing experiences, ministries, but there is much more to do, and so we ask for an awareness and for the ability to meet those needs. This morning, as we celebrate the Holy Communion, may you be especially present with us as we contemplate your great sacrifice, your willingness to give of your life that we might enjoy eternal life. Lord, in all things that remain on our hearts, we lay them before you, knowing and believing that you answer our prayers. We give you the thanks and the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. And now we'll back up a little bit for our recognition of graduates. Thank you, Danny.
I'm glad somebody's on target with things. That's all right. Can I have your microphone so they can tell us what they're going to do?
Sure.
Thanks. Hey, it's that time of year. And we got some graduates that are excited, right? Yeah? Somebody said I was being pretty gutsy because we scheduled this before they graduate. So I'm assuming all is good. Yes? I didn't think there'd be any problem with those two either, but somebody did say something about being gutsy. So I said, well, we have faith in our students. So Keegan Horniman is in Florida, so he is not here, but he graduated from college. Not sure what his plans are now. Anyone?
Military,
thank you. So he's gonna go to the military, so be in prayer for him as he makes that journey. And our high school graduates from Union City are Brady Blakesley. Come on down. And we want you to tell everyone what you're gonna do, where you're going to school, all that good stuff.
I will be going to Slippery Rock University for exercise science and hopefully a doctorate in physical therapy after that.
Wow, all right, so he can take care of all of us. And our other high school grad from Union City is Amber Lassiter. Art.
I'll be going down to Teal College for accounting.
And you're going to make lots of money, and okay, that's good. Let us. What was that?
By farm, have lots of cows.
Yes, by farm, have lots of cows, yes. Well, that makes sense. Dairy Prince's person, yeah. Let's have a word of prayer over our graduates here. Almighty and gracious God, we just thank you for these two young people and the accomplishments that they have been able to achieve through your grace and your mercy. We thank you for their parents that have supported them and their families and their teachers that have helped to educate them and mold them and shape them into the people that they are. And we thank you for the role of this church in molding them and shaping them and helping them to grow in their faith. We ask, dear God, that you would bless them as they head off to further their education and to follow the will, the path that you have laid before them. Bless them, dear God, and allow them to keep close to you as they learn in new things and have new experiences. Allow them to grow in their faith. that it might truly become their faith, and that they might be a witness to all those that we meet. Because we know, dear God, that there are many in this world that don't know you. But we praise you that these two, Brady and Amber, know you and know what you have done for them and what you have done for the world. May they be your witnesses as they go forth. We pray your blessing upon them as they graduate and as they rejoice in this accomplishment with their family and friends. But above all things, we want to give you all the praise and the glory. And all the children of God said,
amen.
Amen. And the church has a gift that Miss Blair will deliver. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations. Let's give them a round of applause. Do you know what I'm supposed to do next?
We're still trying to figure that out, aren't we?
Oh, okay.
We're not having an anthem. We do know that.
We do know there's not an anthem since half of that duet is not here. But we assured Kathy that we would survive without an anthem today. And although Becky wasn't too sure we'd survive without a pianist from the praise band, but you did well, good job. And thank you to Sue for jumping to the organ and helping us out, because we assured her she needed to be with Rick because this was not on their radar, kind of surprise. I've never heard anyone say praise God for a kidney stone before, though. But that's how they found the heart problem, so. Praise God for a kidney stone. Who knew? Talk about working in mysterious ways, oh my. Hey, our scripture passage for today comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 12. Hear these words from the Apostle Paul. Oh, and I forgot Debbie's helping too today. Don't want to forget anybody. The Apostle Paul writes, "Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God said, who said, 'Let light shine out of the darkness,' may his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may also be revealed in our mortal body. So then death is at work in us, but life is at work in you. The word of God for the people of God. I would invite you to stand as you are able, and let us join together in our hymn of preparation, Be Thou My Vision. What was that? Yeah, that's true. That's true. Maybe that'll happen today. I don't know. I tried to keep it short, really. I did. In my 33 years of full-time ordained ministry, I've only missed one ordination service at annual conference. And that was due to a out-of-state family death, so I kind of didn't have a choice. It's always been important for me to attend and hear the questions that are asked of those persons being ordained. The questions are the same every year. They're historic questions that John Wesley asked of his preachers. The questions that have been asked of every Methodist preacher being ordained and are based on Wesley's understanding of ministry and is the teachings of the scriptures and upon his theology. Each year as I hear these questions being asked, these same historic questions being asked of those being ordained, I have answered them again in my own heart, acknowledging once more the call that God has placed on my life as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This year it was refreshing to have Bishop Mark Webb, not that guy, Bishop Mark Webb remind the clergy that we need to renew our response to God's calling on our lives. As the questions were once again asked of those being ordained, all of us needed to answer them. Another part of annual conference that is one of the, I guess, final items is the fixing or setting of appointments by the bishop. Pastors usually stand as the bishop then prays over the ministries of all those appointed. This year was a little different because the laity were asked to stand as well. And the ministry of both were prayed over. It was an acknowledgement of the calling that everyone receives to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. It showed the importance of laity being involved in sharing the gospel. In every church that I know, laity outnumber the clergy. So it only makes sense that the church would have a greater outreach and impact with laity answering their call. No amens on that?
Amen.
I heard you or saw you shaking your head there, Mark. Just imagine, with the number of laity answering their call to ministry. Our lay delegate for annual conference, Marty Irwin, stood not only for herself and her ministry, but also on your behalf as representing you for lay delegate, as lay delegate. So, the ministry of this congregation has been set by Bishop Mark Webb. In a similar way that our taller lay leader, Mark Webb, does each week as he prays for our ministry here at the church, right? I had to do that. It's so much fun. So much fun. Mark's quite a bit taller than Bishop Webb, but same, you know, bearded face, and although his hair is not quite the same color as yours, you don't mind.
Give it time.
Yes, and he keeps doing the job he's doing, he probably will. But in thinking about Bishop Webb's prayer over the ministry of both laity and clergy at annual conference, I couldn't help thinking of all the excuses that I have heard over my 33 years in ministry. Like, things like, I put my time in when I was younger. Let somebody else do it now. Heard that one? Yeah. Or, I teach kids all week. Why would I want to do it on Sunday too? Thank you, Jen Dreyer, for serving and teaching. I don't hear that from her. Might say it behind my back, but she... I don't know the Bible well enough. But who does? Who does? I couldn't. I just couldn't. Or, you know, I don't have the calling or the time. Every pastor, every person who has served on a nominations committee, or anyone who has served as the chair of a committee, has probably heard quite a few excuses as well. 40 years ago, I was struggling with a call to ministry. I'd been selectively volunteered in October of 1983 to preached the Youth Sunday sermon in February of 1984. That was my senior year of high school, and that's a time, as we know, that is normally filled with thoughts of possible careers and professions. After receiving positive feedback from my pastor and many others after that Youth Sunday ministry, entered the picture for the first time for me. Knowing that public speaking was a big part of the job, the introvert in me said, I can't do that. That's not my gift. Youth Sunday was a one-time deal, right? I had months to write that sermon. That'll never happen. I was too quiet and shy to be a pastor. Huh. Talk to people who knew me when I grew up. They will back me up on that one. I didn't think I knew the Bible well enough. I didn't have the gifts. I wasn't good enough. The list was long. And I remember telling my pastor in June, as we shared with our youth group what our future plans were, that I felt called to be active in the church as an adult, wherever I ended up and whatever I ended up doing. By November, I was telling him that I felt called to ministry in some way. I also told him very clearly in November that I didn't feel I had the gifts to be a preacher. Fred didn't say much, but he wasn't surprised to be having that conversation with me. You see, he had already seen gifts. He had already realized my calling. Just took me a bit longer. And even now, there are still days that I wonder. Yeah, whoa is right. He's good. He is good. You know, we live in a world that focuses on perfection in so many ways. Advertisers earn their living by painting a picture of the perfect life to sell their products. Many of which we really don't even need. It makes sense, of course, that, you know, if we purchase the right car or the right clothes, all's going to be well in our world, right? Yeah. Doesn't happen. One of the things that my home pastor, Fred, had learned is that perfection isn't required to serve God. A lesson I'm sure he learned in his own life as well as from the scriptures. After all, Jesus called a tax collector to be a disciple, right? In 2 Corinthians, Apostle Paul is defending his ministry. He begins by reminding his readers that this ministry is not his. It's only through God's mercy and grace that we have this ministry. He tells how they operate and what they preach. They're servants of Christ, and those that cannot see the light of God's glory have been blinded by the God of this age. They preach not themselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord. And in continuing, Paul makes it clear that the real treasure is Jesus Christ. The real treasure is Jesus Christ. Paul is only the clay jar that carries that treasure. And he shares his encouragement because life had not thrown him more than he could handle with God. And as he mentioned some of the difficulties that he has experienced, he also mentions the positive outcome. Life had knocked him down many times, but it had not knocked him out. Our text for today ends with Paul's reminder that Christ is always, always living within us, regardless of what is happening around us. Paul did not let the hardships or his own shortcomings hold him back from doing what God called him to do. When he received his calling to tell the world about Jesus, he did it. And he's still doing it today through his letters. Just as Paul received a calling to tell others about Jesus Christ, each of us have received a calling to tell others about Jesus.
Amen.
Each of us. Every believer in Jesus Christ is called to share the message of salvation in Jesus Christ by the way you live, the choices you make, and yes, by the words you speak. In a few moments, we will be celebrating the sacrament of holy baptism, confirmation, and the sacrament of holy communion. All of these are great opportunities to renew and reaffirm our faith and our calling to share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I hope and pray that as our young people who are joining the church answer the questions they are asked, that in your heart you will answer those same questions and reaffirm your commitment to Jesus Christ and your faith in what he has done. Because we all have received a calling to be in ministry. And we can have an awesome impact in this world when we all answer that call and share the good news of Jesus Christ. And all of God's children said,
Amen.
All right, I would like to invite up our confirmands and their sponsors and Mr. Mark. We want people to be able to hear what you got to say, Mark. And we can just, the candidates and their sponsors can stand along here in pairs. You know. I want you to look this way because I want the congregation to see you. So,
brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is a gift, God's gift, offered to us without price. Through confirmation and through the reaffirmation of our faith, we renew the covenant declaring that our baptism acknowledge what God is doing for us and affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church. I present to you Noah Kenneth Lasker for baptism and confirmation. I present Claudia Ellen Gross and Amber Rose Lasker for confirmation.
In faithfulness with early church practice, early Christian practice, as well as the Wesleyan tradition, those wishing to receive the sacrament of holy baptism and the rite of confirmation within the global Methodist Church shall first we ask the following questions. Do you renounce the devil and all his works and reject the evil powers of this world? Do you repent of your sin, turn to Jesus Christ, and confess him as your Lord and Savior?
I do.
Do you receive and profess the Christian faith as contained in the Holy Scriptures of the Old and New Testaments?
I do.
Do you accept the responsibility to resist evil, injustice, and oppression by the grace and power of God? Will you obediently keep God's holy will and commandments and walk in them all the days of your life by the grace and power of God? Members of the congregation, please affirm your commitment to support the baptismal candidates in their faith. Will you, who witness these vows, encourage these persons in their faith and do all in your power to support them in their life in Christ?
We will.
Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life, and include these persons now before you in your care?
With God's help, we proclaim good news
and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them, that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. Let us confess our faith as contained in the Holy Scriptures of the Old and New Testament. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Mr. Noah, if you would like to come. Pray with the water first, okay? The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you had promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations.
Declare his words to the nations, his glory among all people.
Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and he who receives it, to wash away his sin and clothe him in righteousness throughout his life, that dying and being raised with Christ, he may share in his final victory.
All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever.
We have a long history, can you tell? Do you want to give me your full name? Do you want to give me your full name? Do you have to read it? Yeah. Noah Kenneth Lasser, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. 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 You can go back down and sit there. In addition to taking the vows of baptism, those wishing to become professing members of the Global Methodist Church shall be asked the following questions before being received into the church. Do you believe in God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit? What?
I do.
Thank you. Do you confess Jesus Christ as Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord?
I do.
Do you receive and profess the Christian faith as contained in the Scriptures? Do you promise, according to the grace given you, to keep God's holy will and commandments and walk in the same all the days of your life as a faithful member of Christ's holy church?
I do.
And on behalf of our entire congregation, will you be loyal to Christ and the First Global Methodist Church in Union City and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness as Christ's representative in this world?
I will.
Amen. We will confirm these folks in order that they're listed in the bulletin. So if Claudia and her sponsor, Venter, would come forward along with Mr. Mark there as lay leader. And you may kneel, ma'am. Remember your baptism and be thankful. Amen. Claudia Ellen Gross, may the Holy Spirit work within you that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Remember your baptism and be thankful. Amen. Amber Rose Lassiter, may the Holy Spirit work within you that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. It's going to be hard, but remember your baptism and be thankful that I didn't pour. Amen. Noah Kenneth Lassiter, May the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Go back down there with the rest of the crew. Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love, as members together with you in the body of Christ, and in this congregation of the Holy Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to do all in our power, strengthen its ministries through our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness.
The God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. And all the children of God said,
Amen.
Amen. Hey, let's welcome them. Mr. Mark has membership certificates for each of them. He also has a baptismal certificate for Mr. Noah. And there are covenants that he has signed and I have signed on behalf of the church. And there's a place that their mentors will sign, saying that we have witnessed their promises that they made today. And there's a place where they will sign and date it so that they can always have a reminder of the promises that they made today. Because I reworded them all. Instead of "do you," I said "I do," and made them all into statements. But it's a reminder of the promises they made. And our confirmation experience, our nurture in them has not ended. It is continuing on, and I hope and pray that you will all continue to be in contact with your mentors and work with them and grow in your spiritual life. And one of the biggest things I want to remind you is to be in prayer daily. Be in communication with God. And you'll notice that there were a couple little stones up there that said that. You each can have one to serve as a reminder. But let us congratulate them. And thank you to the mentors for journeying with the kids. It's been fun. We missed a few classes that we would have liked to have had, but you know, that happens. And I look forward to continuing to see these folks grow in their faith and their witness in this world. Because they're smart cookies up here. Smart cookies, so hallelujah! You may head back to your seat until we call you up for communion. Christ the Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God,
We confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to gain your leading to church. We have not done your work. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your law. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard our cry of need. Free us from sin. Free us from joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We lift up our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, sun and lights. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, sun and lights.
Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, and broke the bread, giving it to his disciples and saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the whole world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray as we have been taught. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
A reminder to all of you that this table of the Lord is open to all who wish to come and receive. You don't have to be a member of this church or of any church. You just need to believe in what Jesus Christ has done for the world. Those that desire individual communion prepackaged cups, there are some available. We also have gluten-free available for those in need of that. As you come forward, I will give you a piece of bread and we'll take it and dip it into the cup and then take and eat. The altar's open. If you would like to spend time in prayer, feel free to do so. And just again, a reminder, this altar, this table, this communion table is open to all who wish to come and receive. If our new members would come forward and Mark to help us serve communion today. Thank you. Christ gave his all for us. That's what we have remembered as we have gathered at the Lord's table. That's what we've remembered as we celebrated the sacrament of baptism and the rite of confirmation. Christ has given us his all. Prayerfully consider what God is calling you to give of what you have received. So if the ushers would please come forward so that we can return to God a portion of what we have received. Together. We dedicate these gifts, Lord, for the work of your church,
asking that you use all that we have and all that we are in your service.
Amen. I would ask that you remain standing as you are able, as we join together in our closing hymn, Here I Am, Lord. This hymn was one of the hymns at my first ordination service. And it's been sung at quite a few. It's a hymn that was written for the consecration of missionaries. So we're going to celebrate our consecration of you as children of God called into ministry. Amen?
Amen.
Let us sing together.
Thank you.
I don't know if I can follow that. New members and sponsors, mentors, whatever name you choose to, we want, and Mark, we want to get a picture of the group up front, so come down and Mr. Nate has the camera. You know, we have been called. Each and every one of us have been called. In the night, in the daytime, sometimes it's on the phone, sometimes it's a still small voice. Sometimes it's a 2x4 upside the head. Just being honest. But God is calling each and every one of us. Each and every one of us. So look in your life. Open your heart to see where God is calling you to be in ministry. And to whom he is calling you to share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. May your response be the same as the prophet Isaiah, "Here I am." And all God's people said,
"Amen."